Father, we give you praise tonight for these wonderful numbers in this exciting time. The gospel of the kingdom of God is being preached. And I'm glad. Amen. Now, let's receive our evening offering and give you an opportunity to raise your income. Amen. Open your Bibles to the book of Matthew. Oh, yes, sir. Thank you, Lord. Yeah, I'll be blessed to do that. Before we do that, I just got directions from the Lord to go to the book of Colossians. Chapter 1. And let's look at verse 12. Giving thanks unto the Father. He'll be all right in a minute. They'll pray for him. Where's Mac? Can't you do anything with it? We already know you can't, so sit down. Oh, I love these guys. All right, verse 12, Colossians 1, 12. Giving thanks unto the Father, which has, H-A-T-H, past tense. This is very, very important to see that this is not something that's going to happen. This has already happened. Hath made us, M-E-E-T, is an old English word for able, A-B-L-E, or enabled us. He has made us able to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who has already delivered us from the power or the authority of darkness, and has already translated us into the kingdom of God's dear Son. All right. Now, let's look in the third chapter, verse 1. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affection, your mind, your thoughts, on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Now, Ephesians chapter 2. I'm going to stop off at the book of Philippians, chapter 3, verse 20. For our conversation, our manner of life, or our citizenship, in other translations, is in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven. Now, Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 4, God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, he loved us even when we were dead in sins, has made us alive together with Christ, with the Anointed One. By grace you are saved, and has, H-A-T-H, past tense, raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. Now, he's raised us up. He has translated us out of the kingdom of darkness over into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Our citizenship is in heaven. Amen. Amen. We've been raised up together and made to sit together with him in heavenly places. Sitting where? On the throne of grace. Amen. We're not gathered around the throne. We sit on that throne. This is God's concept of you and me. Now the scripture says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be called equal with God. And I'm sad to say tonight that most Christian people, if you walk up to a born-again child of God and say, are you equal with God? Oh, no. It's too bad you don't know that. Sin consciousness gives you the idea that if you were to call yourself holy, or if you were to call yourself, you know, joint heir with Christ Jesus, which is simply what the scripture says, being equal with God, that somehow or another you're stealing from his holiness and his deity, when actually you're insulting him. I've heard people say, well, you know, Brother Copeland, there's really only one Jesus. Well, that sounds awful humble and all that, but it's just New Testament ignorance. Yeah, that's right. No! If there was only one Jesus, then that was not a sacrifice, it was a murder. Amen. I realize that's pretty tough talk, but I ain't got long food with you tonight. Amen. I'm tired of playing church anyway. God gave him to bring many souls into his kingdom and glory. Many sons to glory. No, thank God, there's not just one Jesus. He's not the only begotten Son of God. He's never called that from the book of Acts through the book of Revelation. He's called the firstborn from the dead. And we are joint heirs with him. Amen. Hallelujah. I did it again. I don't preach me happy. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, the Lord wanted me to, instructed me a moment ago by the word of the Lord, to read these and get this, get our minds into this concept that God has of us seated with him in heavenly places. Amen. Yes, yes. Amen. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've done all the dying you're ever going to do. You don't die and go to heaven. You already in heaven. Amen. If you don't go to heaven till after you die, you ain't going.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, once we have this concept of us that God has, and the reason why God did all this in the first place, we begin to understand some things about Jesus. He never did anything on this earth in his earthly ministry as the Son of God. Not one thing. He emptied himself of his divine privileges. Now he went to the cross as the Son of God. But I'm talking about in his earthly ministry, he preached the gospel as a prophet under the Abrahamic covenant, anointed of God, a man baptized in the Holy Ghost. And he did not do anything that's not available to you and me. Amen. By the same process. Because see, we've been reborn. We're not just old forgiven sinners. Saved by grace. No, I was an old sinner, but I got saved by grace. That changed everything, man. Now then, now follow me in this. That means that by the same process that Jesus did everything while he was on the earth is available now to you and me with him as head of the church and us filled with his Spirit. That's what we're about. What is the process again? You remember what he said, John 14? We'll read it again later. The words that I speak unto you are not my own, but the Father that dwelleth within me, he does the work. Okay, now say it with me. The words that I speak unto you are not my own. It's the Father that dwelleth within me. He does the works. Now go back and read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John very, very carefully, and every incident in his life, apply that. Amen. Amen. And all of a sudden, the mysteries of the kingdom of God just open up. And when he said, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do. How? Same process. Stop speaking our own words. Inquire of God. Speak his words. And the Father that dwelleth within, he does the works. You can't change that process. It's the kingdom process. You can't change it. All you can do is change the words. And that's what Satan tries to do and tries to alter things by manipulating the process, but he can't change it. He's stuck with it. Praise God. Now, let's go to the book of Matthew. And let's look in the 14th chapter. You know the story about John the Baptist, verse 10. He sent and beheaded John in prison. Herod did that. His head was brought in a charger, given to the damsel. She brought it to her mother. His disciples came, took up the body, buried it, and went and told Jesus. When Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place. Now, please, do not get the idea that he went there to grieve. No, he's not full of grief. Now, don't misunderstand me. It hit him like it would you, anybody else. That was the only man on earth that in the beginning of Jesus' ministry knew who he was. But there was a plan in operation. Jesus knew that. But he did decide to go out into this desert place. Now, wait a minute. Apply the process. Remember what Jesus said in John 5. I can do nothing of myself. Didn't say I won't do it. Said I can't do anything by myself. But the Father has shown me what I must do and what I must say. He knew where he was going. How did he know? The Father told him to go out there. Now, what did he tell him to go out there to do? I don't know, but I know what he did. Amen. See, he's just following the Spirit of God. He didn't go out there to grieve. He went out there because the Father told him to go out there. Now, you see what I'm saying about applying this exact process to everything Jesus did and said? Now, He went by ship into a desert place apart. When the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the cities. Jesus went forth, saw a great multitude, and was moved by compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. Satan had attacked him in his family. Jesus attacked Satan on the faith field of battle, and he started healing the sick. That's the way kingdom people respond and react. Amen. We react to death by attacking. We react to sickness and disease by being moved by compassion. Compassion is not a feeling, it's a person. Amen. What does that mean, being moved by compassion? Does that mean there's something, you know, kind of come all over him to where he just can't stand it till I pray for somebody? No, no, no. Compassion told him what to do. And what to say. He did it and said it. Glory. Now, watch this whole process very carefully. When it was evening, now they're out there in a desert place. No water, no food, and it's getting dark. Desert's dangerous out there at night. The disciples came to him saying, "This is a desert place. The time is now past. Send the multitude away that they may go into the village and buy themselves food." Excuse me? The man's healing the sick. And they're going to come up and tell him to stop the meeting? I'm not going to do that. I don't care if we're out there all night. I'm not butting in on that. What's happening? The common sense ruled mind butting in. Stop the meeting. Send the people away. Now you got two voices talking to him. You know he's there because the Father told him to be there, and you know he only says what he hears his Father say, and he only does what he sees his Father do. But now he's got other voices talking to him here, reminding him what time of day it is. It is too late. These people are in trouble. Quit preaching and let them go. Those two voices are still in operation today. Amen. But Jesus said to them, "They need not depart, you feed them." What? What are you talking about? Now that answer was not expected at all. But now you and I, by this time, should be expecting that. We should be thinking like that. Notice what he said. You feed them. They said, "We have but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He said, "Well, bring them here to me." He commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, took the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes. Now look what he did. This is just huge. Jesus is functioning in the kingdom of God. He is not connected to that Babylonian system. He's not connected to that desert. He is connected to the kingdom of God. You and I are connected to the kingdom of God. We need to be living and functioning in the kingdom of God, not this Babylonian system out here where we were raised. That has all the earmarks of a mini, M-I-N-I, a little small famine. Huh? There's no food out there. There's no water out there. And when it gets dark, there's bad and ugly things out there. that they have no power against. They didn't come out there equipped to have any power against all that. So what do? You're going to function in the kingdom. If you function in the kingdom, it don't make any difference where you are. You're functioning in the blessing of Abraham. That's what he was functioning in. The blessing's on the inside of you right now. Jesus was made to be a curse for us so that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through him, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. That blessing's in you and on you just as much and in equal quantity and quality that's in you and on you right now. You have the same measure of faith in you that he had then and that he has now. Brother Copeland, how can you say that? I read the book a lot. I just say what it says. We've been given the measure of faith. Same faith the Apostle John, same faith the Apostle Peter had, same faith that the Apostle Paul had. Peter said, you that have received like precious faith with us. Well, where'd they get it? Jesus is the author and the developer of our faith. Some people use it and develop it. Other people just sit around with it. But it starts out at the same level. He's given unto every man among us the measure of faith. Now, here we go again. He blessed, look what he did now. He blessed. What do you think he said? Now remember, you got to apply the process. I only say those things that my Father has taught me. So there's no way he's going to make up some kind of prayer over this bread and fish. He's going to say the same thing the Father said to Adam. He's going to say the same thing he said to Noah. Be fruitful and multiply. And then what he's wanting this to do is multiply. Well, he blessed, be fruitful and multiply. Now, well, where does that leave us? Let me ask you something. Have you ever read the book of Exodus? 23:25. You will serve the Lord your God. He will bless your bread and bless your water and take sickness from the midst of you. Whoa. Now there's a table prayer for you. Instead of, God bless this food, the nourishment of my body, bless the cook that cooked it, and you know, and the gardener that picked it or whatever. Let's be like Jesus. Let's not use our own words. Let's go to his words and use that. I tell you, you can get so excited over lunch that you don't eat. The scripture said our food is sanctified through thanksgiving, prayer, and faith. Amen. What did he do? He blessed it. Now, you need to start doing this because you and I have been given the same authority to bless that Jesus had when he was on earth. Amen.
Amen.
And begin to bless. Begin to bless. Bless food. Bless things. Bless people. And expect to get the same results that he got. Amen. Increase does not begin with your job. Increase begins on the inside of here in the blessing of the Lord. Hallelujah. Increase comes from the word. Increase begins with your lips. He blessed and brake and gave the loaves to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. The miracle happened in the hands of the disciples. They're the ones that passed it out. They're the ones that saw it multiply. They're the ones that fed the people. If your Bible up at the top says Jesus fed the multitude, put a little arrow out beside that and say, no, he didn't. The disciples did. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Yeah. Didn't that what Jesus said? You feed them. Amen. Now you know what happens. You come to the Lord and you say, oh, Lord, I need all this and I need all that. And the Lord say, no, you do it. Yes. Now, what happened when he said that? This is the point of this. When the Father told Jesus what to say and what to do, his telling him authorized him to do it. Amen. And when he did it by faith, he was empowered to carry it out by the Father that authorized him to do it. And ain't no different with you. God tells you like he told me back there. I'll tell you, my entire budget for the whole year was $350,000-some-odd. A whole year. And right at the end of that year, the word of the Lord came to me, and he said, I want you on every gospel radio station in North America. I just said, yes, sir. I didn't have any stations. I didn't know there's 700 stations out there. I just said, yes. Amen. By the end of the next year, my radio bill was $400,000 a month. Well, where am I going to get that kind of money? I ain't my job. Ain't my job to raise money. My job was to go on radio. Amen. I don't have to pay for it. I have to bleed for it. I've been in the ministry 46 years. I ain't never paid for anything. I believe for it. God paid for it. That's the reason you don't have to go in debt. When he told me to get on those stations, that authorized me to do it. When I agreed to do it, the Father that dwelleth within me brought it to pass. That's the process. That's the way it works. Amen. Oh, my dear brother and sister, does that ever take the pressure off of you? Glory to God. You can just, you just like Brother Jesse. He gets some TV bills in. He said, you got mail. The Lord, you got mail. Amen. Now, look at this again. They all did eat and were filled. They took up the fragments that remained 12 baskets full. And they that had eaten were about 5,000 men besides women and children. Now, what happened? This happened to you and me right here tonight while we were reading this. We started off with the murder of John the Baptist. Terrible, horrible crime. Bad thing. By the time we got into the ministry of Jesus and we began along with him to minister to those people, that tragedy just moved into the background. You know why? Because Jesus took victory over the whole matter. That's right. Amen. That desert belonged to him. Hallelujah. I mean, that food belonged to him. That fish belonged to him. That bread belonged to him. Why? Because he took ownership of it in the Spirit, and he blessed it by listening for and inquiring of the words of the Father. The Father moved, glory to God, because he had empowered his Son, and his Son, by faith, had empowered him. Amen. Come on, shout amen. I mean, that's it. That's where amen goes, and right there. Because you have been authorized to do the very same thing. He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these. How? Same process. Don't do anything without inquiring of the Lord. And then don't say anything that you don't hear him say. And don't do anything that you don't see him do. Amen. I've had times in past, I was absolutely determined that I was going to follow that process.
People come in, what are you going to do? You got to do something. I'm not doing anything. No. Get upset with me. Amen. I'm not going to go make up something just to go do something. Yeah. I've gone to the TV studio at times in the past, and I had no message. And I'm just sitting there looking at that camera with nothing to say. And I keep going into my spirit after it, and I'm saying, sir, you know, hello here, you know. But I finally get up, and I say, I'm going to the house. I'm going home. We got to put some, hey, no, I don't have to put, I'm not going to put something on that tape just to fill up the tape. I'm not going to do that. I gave my word to God I wouldn't do that. Got up and went to the house. One day I did that. And Gloria was there at the studio. And Gloria at that time, the only thing she was doing was healing school. That's what God had told her to do. And that was it. So, I just got up and walked out. I said, I do not have anything. I have inquired of the Lord, and he has said nothing. He either has said nothing or I hadn't heard it. And that tantamount to the same thing. Now you understand? So I'm done. I just got in the car and left. They looked at Gloria and said, what are we going to do? She said, I'll do it. Bless her heart. We look back on it now. Now I know why the Lord wasn't saying anything to me. He was drawing her into that daily broadcast. Amen. I wasn't expecting that. And so I hadn't inquired of the Lord of that. And actually, truth be known, I missed it. And after that happened, I realized that that's what he was saying to me all the time. And here we are, how many years later? Amen. And she looks at me. She'll get up and head over there to the studio. She said, I guess you know that I had to get up this morning early. I had to get dressed. I have to go over there and do television today because one time you quit. I say, uh-huh, that's right. Turn the alarm clock off while you go on your way out. Now, I'm lying and you know I'm lying. There ain't no way I'd get away with that. You know I didn't do that. Amen. Now, that takes all the pressure off. Well, I got to build this church. No, you don't. No, you don't. Jesus said, on this rock, I will build my church. Now, when you figure that out, Pastor, and those of you that are pastors and don't know it, that God's been calling you for the last 17 years, and you've been saying, I'm not qualified, I'm not qualified. The day he called you, qualified you. God is fully aware of your education and your lack of it. He's qualified. He's looking for obedience. Amen. And the less the world's taught you, the more highly you qualified. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we pray and we thank you for this offering tonight. As we come before you with what we have and what you have instructed us to do. Yes, sir, I will. Thank you. I remember I was praying a number of years ago over some financial things and all of the radio and the television and all of that and it was all growing and growing and growing. We're just doing our best to keep up with it.
And I had inquired of the Lord about some of these things. And the word of the Lord came to me. Now, I'm not talking about some audible voice. If it come in an audible voice, I'd have to test that. I am not impressed at all with audible voices. Not at all. I'm looking for the voice of the Lord that's in here. Every Christian has it. Be quiet and listen. Develop it by listening. What was it Rufus Mosley said, lying in the floor in the hotel room in Chicago, crying out, squalling out before God, and suddenly he quit and said, "Here lies a fool, knows nothing, doing all the talking to somebody that knows everything." And he said, "I believe I'll shut up and let him talk for a while." That's a picture of most of us, one time or another. I heard the Lord say, "I want you to send Brother Hagin $50,000. Well, I didn't have $50,000. The moment he said that, I had $50,000. Now, what needs to happen is for it to materialize from the world of the spirit into the world of the natural. Amen. I said, "Yes, sir." I agreed to it. "I'll do it. Thank you, sir." And so I just started with what I had and sent that in. Wasn't much, $20, $25. I just started whatever was on me just to get it into action. You understand? Just to be obedient. And I'd come in at night and empty out my pockets, and everything in my pockets would go to Brother Hagin. And somebody'd hand me something, I'd send it to Brother Hagin. And I wasn't keeping track of it. I'm just sending offerings. I'm sending this, I'm sending that. And I'm just enjoying it and having a big time. The more I gave, the more I sowed into Brother Hagin's ministry, the more excited about it I got, because I was already partnering with his ministry anyway. And this was all over and above what we were already doing on a monthly basis. Gloria and I got so excited about it. And good while went by, I finally thought, you know, I wonder how much I've put in this already. So I called his office and had him check. I was already past my $50,000 and didn't know it. I thought, look at this. Whoa, mama's little country boy, Queenie, had put $50,000 in that man's ministry. I absolutely liked, I lost it. I danced, shouted, kicked the furniture across the room. Praise God. I knew in my heart I could do that, but I didn't have the concept in my mind. See, I didn't know then what I'm telling you now. I know now that when I agreed, he empowered me by the blessing to do it. And everything I did multiplied in my hands. Everything I did multiplied. Just like the loaves and the fishes. Right. Amen. 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 Well, I'm talking to somebody. Amen. The rest of you can listen in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Praise God. If you need an envelope for your giving, raise your hands. Ushers have them there. Name that seed. Name it. Call it. This is seed towards my breakthrough. This is seed towards the removal of debt in my life. This is seed towards my healing. This is seed towards my children coming to God. Name that seed. Call it. Write it down someplace. Amen. Hallelujah.